Greetings, Rob Chassner. Continuing in our study of the Gospel of Matthew, we're in chapter 13, and this study will begin in verse 47 today. As you remember, in chapter 13, we have the parables of the kingdom. This is where Jesus takes a story out of everyday life, and everybody would understand when he puts this story out there, to teach a spiritual principle. It is a story to help us in our understanding. Now, we have already gone through six of these parables. So far, what we have seen is in the parable of the sower. Whenever you have a religious gathering, a Bible study, or a church service, or something like that, that when we get when the word of God goes out, that there are different hearts. And they're going to receive this message differently. There are people who are very sincere, who want to know God. They give serious considerations for that, for what God's will is in their life. And so they hear the word of God, they put it to their memory, and they intend to be obedient to the word of God and respond in the proper way. Then you have other people where the message is being delivered, it goes right in one ear and out the other. And they're going to forget everything that they heard by the time they get to the parking lot. So there are others who will make an emotional decision. They will be told somehow Jesus will fix their marriages or their finance or whatever problem or struggle they're having in their life. And when Jesus does not fix all of those things we have in our life, then their faith begins to wither quickly when they're under the pressures of life. And then there are people who are who are sincere. They latch onto the word, and just because of life's pressure, their commitment to God seems to get pushed down to the bottom of the priority list. And at that point, we see no longer any fruit coming from that person's life. Then the second parable, we talked about the parable of the wheat and the tares. Where there was darnel grass, which looks similar to the wheat, and we're taught that whenever you had a genuine work of God, there's always going to be counterfeits, such as Mormonism or Jehovah's Witnesses. They are all counterfeits of genuine Christianity. The third parable, whenever you have church growth, remember we talked about the mustard seed. It's a very small seed, and it's planted in the ground, and it has abnormal growth or supernatural growth. It grows into a very huge tree, so then that eventually evil comes in and lodges in its branches, and that's exactly what we see in the church history. For the first few hundred years of the church, we are being beaten to a pulp, but the church's work was pure. But then the church began to take over and control the governments of the world. And where there's money and a concentration of power, which is appealing to the flesh, then all of a sudden evil men and women begin to gravitate to the church. You know, the Crusades and the Spanish Inquisition was not Jesus Christ. That was the doing of evil men. Who came in and took over control of the church. And what that proves is that Jesus is an authentic prophet, because that's exactly what he prophesied and said would happen. The fourth parable was about the woman putting the leaven into the measures of the meal, leaven being used as deception or sin, teaching us not everyone who claims to speak for God is going to be genuine just because I have a big Bible or a big cross, or just because someone says, thus saith the Lord, it does not mean that they are authentic, but rather the Bible tells us that you test all things and you hold fast to that which is good. So in other words, you align everything with Scripture. The fifth and sixth parables, the parable of the hidden treasure, the parable of the pearl of great price, teach us that even though the church is going to have all kinds of issues and problems, Jesus Christ is in love with us anyway. Maybe your friends and your families don't think much of you. What does the Lord think of you? You are the pearl of great price. You are the treasure that is hidden. You are so valuable to the Lord that he was willing to surrender everything in order that he might have a relationship with you. Now we have the seventh parable beginning this study in verse 47, which says, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet that was cast into the sea and gathered some of every kind. Now there were about 25 different species of fish in the Galilee at this time, all of which were gathered into the net. Now verses 48 to 50 say, which when it was full, they drew to shore, and they sat down and gathered the good into vessels and threw the bad away. So it will be at the end of the age. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come forth, separate the wicked from from among the just, and cast them into a furnace of fire. But there will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. So as you know, this dragnet was a very large net, about 300 feet long, the size of a football field, and they had corks along the top, and that they would so that it would float, and it weighed. They put weights on it so that it would go down to the bottom, and then they would take it out into the water. And when the timing was right, they would drag it from the bottom all the way up to the shoreline, and there'd be every type of species of fish. Some were very tasty and some were horrible. And so they put this great big pile of fish, they separated it, and the good tasting fish they would put in one container to take to the market. And then the others they would destroy that would taste like garbage so that those bad fish would not take food from the good fish out of the Sea of Galilee, nor would they multiply. What Christ is telling us here is there's going to be a day when there will be a great separation, but for now things can be confusing. Have you ever heard people say, I don't know what church to join? You know, they're all a bunch of wackos. And if you ask, you know, one believes this and one believes that, and I don't know what I'm supposed to believe, you know, who speaks for God and who doesn't speak for God, it can be very confusing. Christ is saying there's a day at which will come when there will be a great separation between the good with the Lord and those who are bad with the Lord or wrong with the Lord. Now you remember the Apostle John had a visitation or a vision, if you will, at the end of the book of Revelation. He sees the city of God, he sees the presence of God, and John says in this vision, on the outside there were dogs. He's not referring to little, you know, golden retrievers or puppies. This was a derogatory term that was used in the Bible for those who were profane. Revelation 22:15 says, but outside are the dogs, the sorcerers, the sexual immoral, the murderers, the idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. And so there's going to be a dividing line. There's going to be a separation at some point in the future. Now remember that the earlier parables, Jesus is speaking to everyone in the crowd, then Jesus goes into the house and the disciples follow him and gives the disciples the last several parables. Now he continues to speak directly to the disciples. Verse 51, Jesus said to them, that's the disciples, have you understood all these things? Then they said to him, yes, Lord. All right, so likely they did understand what Jesus was saying, or Jesus might have called them out on that, because Jesus knows all. And so they are beginning to understand the messages of the parable. Verse 52 says, then he said to them, therefore every scribe instructed concerning the kingdom of the heaven is like a householder who brings out of his treasure things new and old. And so Jesus says to these guys that he will eventually one day say, I want you to go to all of the people of the world. I want you to make all people disciples, teaching them whatsoever I have taught to you. He says in verse 52, okay, you got this rich guy. Now imagine you go to this rich guy's mansion and you ask him, what are you doing with your money lately? And he says, well, I just bought a couple of items, a couple of things. You won't believe this. He takes you to a room. He says, I just bought this from, you know, from the antique auction the other day. Don't ask me what I paid for it. It was absolutely obscene, but it's a 16th century piece of art. Only two were ever made. And the only other one that was in the world was destroyed in the fire of London. And this is the only one remaining. So it's a priceless antique. And he's showing you something old out of his treasure. And then he takes you over to his office and he shows you some gizmo that a friend of his has made. And it's not even on the market yet. It's some kind of computerized machine that reads your mind. And he's showing you something new out of his treasures. Now, Jesus says to his disciples that they are going to be like someone who is showing you treasure that is new and old. When you go through the book of Acts, what do you see there? You find Peter standing up there on the day of Pentecost saying, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In other words, he's going back into the ancient text, the Old Testament, hundreds of years earlier, and he's saying, giving a new application prior to Pentecost. Now, Peter says to the 120 gathered in that upper room, I'm reading from the book of Psalms, and it seems to me that this is speaking of Judas. He's referring to Judas Iscariot, that he is to lose his office and it is to be given to another. And so Peter is, what he's doing here is he's reaching back into the old and he's bringing a new application to it. And that is what the disciples were called to do, to bring the Old Testament into focus for New Testament believers. Verses 53 and 4 say, it came to pass when Jesus had finished these parables, he departed from there. When he had come to his own country, he taught them in their synagogue, so that they were astonished and said, where did this man get this wisdom and these mighty works? It would be important for us to keep this synoptic verses of Matthew 13 from the Gospel of Luke in mind, because Luke gives us some insight Matthew doesn't give us. Notice in verse 54, it says, when he had come to his own country. The way that Luke describes this in Luke 4, verse 16, it says, then Jesus came to Nazareth, where he was brought up. The reason why we need to keep this in mind is because, you know, when you're watching cable network or History Channel and you have some goofball come on and talking about the historic Jesus, and they start talking about where was he during the silent years between his age of 12 and 30, his ages of 12 to 30, and they make up some information and they call it factual. Jesus, you know, they're saying was sitting in the Himalayas, sitting at the feet of some mystic, the mystic leader of that day, and he became one of the ascended masters. Then he migrated back to Palestine and takes advantage of the uneducated and the superstitious that are in the Galilee region, and he pulls a few rabbits out of his hat, and lo and behold, they believe that he's the Messiah. Well, where was he during the silent years? It's very clear. Luke tells us he was in Nazareth. Luke is telling us that Jesus's hometown, that's where he grew up. Notice also in Luke 4:16, it says, as was his custom, he entered into the synagogue on the Sabbath and where he stood up to read. Now, Jesus was raised in Nazareth, and having been raised in Nazareth, he had developed a habit or a custom of going to synagogue on the Sabbath day. The reason why this is so important is there's a lot of Christians today who believe it's okay not to be in regular fellowship with anyone else. And there's an aspect of that which is okay, it's true, but interesting that here you have the sinless Son of God who we as Christians claim that we are imitating, and Jesus made it a habit to make sure he was in fellowship with the people who are into the Word of God. It's important for us to hang out with like-minded people. And there are several, you know, there's also a level of accountability with other believers, that there is some typical, you know, some type of prayer ministry, you know, that you are at least comfortable enough that you are going to say to somebody, look, I'm facing a challenge, would you pray for me? The other thing in Matthew 13:54, where it says, they were astonished. Luke tells us that these religious leaders were so mad at Jesus Christ that they not only wanted to kill him, but they were actually in the process of killing him. Now imagine how emotional you would have to be not only to want to kill somebody, but actually putting into action steps to fill this desire to kill an innocent person. You'd have to be pretty worked up. Now notice in verse 54, it says, where did this man get this wisdom and these mighty works? If you go to the literal text in Greek, it says, where this one, this wisdom and power, it doesn't even make sense. These people are so angry that they're spewing out gibberish, but you can still figure out what they're saying, but they can't say it because they're so upset. What we see in the people of Nazareth is what we might call an anatomy or the anatomy of unbelief. If there is a person who is living their life not believing God, there is a picture which begins to take shape. Notice the first thing regarding the anatomy of unbelief. They are essentially saying, where does this guy get off to tell us how we are to be living our lives? They're questioning his authority. Where does he get off coming into our synagogue and begin to tell us this is how we are to live? This is what we are to do. This is how what we need to change. And today, how many times do you hear people say, you and your Bible and Jesus, how dare you criticize my lifestyle? How dare you criticize the choices I'm making in my life? They don't want any the absolute truth. If you press the issue, they begin to respond with threats and hatred. Well, what is that? That's the anatomy of unbelief. Now, there's another thing about unbelief that's going on here. Notice verse 55. Is this not the carpenter's son? Is this not his mother called Mary? And his brothers James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas? Isn't it interesting that Jesus was raised at home, and where the name of the betrayer Judas would have been spoken often? You know, Judas passed the ketchup. Judas take out the garbage. You know, this was all in his life, in Jesus's life as he was growing up in his home. Verse 56 says, and his sisters, are they not all with us? Where did this man get all of these things? Again, the anatomy of unbelief, there's a questioning of authority and there's a questioning of the person of Jesus Christ. In other words, they are likely thinking this guy cannot be the Messiah. He's not exotic enough. He doesn't come from a prominent family. He's just an ordinary guy. And so unbelief begins to belittle Jesus and to make him less than who he really is. And so when you look at Islam, Buddhism, Mormonism, Jehovah's Witnesses, you know, what is that? That is making Christ less than what the Bible says that Jesus is. And this is going to continue until there's a great separation, which comes when every enemy of Christ is going to be placed under his feet, and there they will declare that he is the Messiah, the Lord, and Christ alone. Verse 57 says, so they were offended at him, but Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor except in his own country and in his own house. So they stumble over Christ. Now, who do you say that Jesus is? The answer that, you know, to that question can be done in the quietness of your own heart. Who is Jesus? And is he God who is manifested into the flesh? Or was he some misunderstood guy that just ended up at the wrong place at the wrong time? Now, these people here, they're stumbling, they're tripping over Jesus. And those people who are saved, they are standing upon Jesus. There are two things that you can do with Jesus. Either you can stand upon Jesus as your sole source of salvation. He's the bedrock of your salvation. Or you can trip over him. How many people do you know who are tripping over Jesus? You know, they're saying, oh, come on. You know, do you actually believe that stuff? You know, do you believe that stuff in the Bible, that ancient book? Or, you know, you believe that's the only way you can get to heaven? These people are tripping over Jesus Christ. Why is this important? Now let's look at verse 58. Now he did not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. Notice it does not say he did not do any mighty works. It says he did not do many mighty works. I'm sure that Jesus wanted to heal every single person in Nazareth. We have already seen him do this earlier in the book of Matthew in other communities. He went into a community and he healed everybody. I'm sure he wanted to do the same thing in his hometown, Nazareth, but he is not able to because of their unbelief. It's kind of a weird thing. You and I are able to stand in the way of the God of the universe to keep him from doing what he really wants to do in each of our lives. In fact, in Psalm 78, the New Living Translation, speaking of Israel in the wilderness, verse 41 says, "Again and again they tested God's patience and provoked the Holy One of Israel." The New King James Version puts it like this: "Yes, again and again they tempted God and limited the Holy One of Israel." Isn't it fascinating that a human being, weak and frail as we are, can actually stand before the living God and keep the living God from what he really wants to accomplish? We can limit him and frustrate him. If we do not pray, if we do not believe, then we are going to be limiting God on what he can do in our lives. Ask yourself, how many wonderful things does God want to bring forth into your life? But we are either not praying or not asking or frustrating God due to the fact that we are limiting all of the wonderful things that God wants to have. And so we frustrate God because of our lack of faith, because of our lack of praying to him on what's going on in our lives. So as far as we know, this was the very last time that Jesus visited Nazareth. Yeah, I don't think you can find one book, one scripture in the New Testament after this that shows that he was back in Nazareth. This is where unbelief will eventually lead a person. One of the saddest realities in life is the day when we stand before the Lord and all of a sudden God is revealing to us all of the great things which he wanted to do. The Bible says that he is going to wipe away all tears. When I look back on my life and I see what an idiot that I had been in so many different occasions, and I see how many times I frustrated the plan of God in my life, I'm wondering if I won't be shedding a few tears at that time. But we serve a very kind and generous and gracious God, and he will wipe those tears away. The anatomy of unbelief is this: is the questioning and rejecting of the authority of Jesus Christ, and the questioning and the rejecting of the person of Jesus Christ. That is going to be the great separation, and the separation is not going to be determinable what kind of a good church person that you are. The separation is going to be based upon what you say of Jesus Christ. Is he the person who you're standing upon, or is he the person you're tripping over? And if you're tripping over him, the Bible is warning you that there are very unpleasant things coming in your future. But if you be that person who says, "Yes, I believe in Jesus, that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no man is going to the Father but through him," the Holy Spirit, by his power, is going to bring revelation into your heart, and you are the treasure which is hidden. You are the pearl of great price in the eyes of God. You are so important to the Lord of glory that he is willing to surrender all that he might have a relationship with you. The mistake which you and I have made in the past, it doesn't matter. The grace of God can go much deeper than the sin has gone in our lives. And if you would, by faith, stand on Jesus Christ for past, for present, and for future, the revelation of the love of God will flood your soul. Amen to that? Okay, I hope this has been helpful and informative. Our next study in the Gospel of Matthew will begin in chapter 14, and we'll do verses 1 through 12. Thank you for viewing, and good day.